Hi everyone, and welcome to my presentation, titled Frisson, Emotion, and Synthetic Gestalts, The Emotional Implications of Expressive Meaning in Debussy's Cello Sonata. How is music as a cognitive system able to express emotion? What exactly is happening when certain sounds contain such expressive potential that they cross into thresholds of physical and even psychological arousal? Let's consider, for example, when Finnish composer and conductor Esa-Pekka Salonen begins to weep at the sound of the second theme in the second movement of Sibelius's Second Symphony. After repeated listenings to this piece, I too share tears with Salonen at this very moment. But how does this music's syntactic structures and the expressive meanings we ascribe to them contribute to such poignant aesthetic responses? What mechanisms are at play during these experiences, and how might we theorize about such phenomena? These questions do not yield easy answers. Understanding music's perceived emotions is to travel an intricate web of linked musical events or systems, which include, but are not limited to, syntactic and statistical relationships. And here Leonard Meyer describes the difference between the syntactical and statistical as the difference between primary musical parameters, such as melody, rhythm, and harmony, and secondary musical parameters, such as dynamics, tempo, and texture, respectively. Meaning, or more applicably, expressive meaning, seeks to ascribe a narrative to the musical discourse, often drawing on extramusical or rhetorical associations. And here we might think of musical hermeneutics or semiotics. Cultural associations, where a listener may embody emotions through a sense of nationalistic pride. This could be exemplified in a British listener, for example, who feels a deep sense of nostalgia while listening to Elgar's Nimrod variation, or, as we just saw, a Finnish listener, like Salonen, who responds emotionally to the music of his fellow countryman, Sibelius. And finally, biological and environmental factors, where David Huron, for example, noticed that emotional responses to music that induce chills or goosebumps in the listener are more easily evoked when the ambient temperature in a given room is lower rather than higher. Nevertheless, these domains shade into one another to create a complex, gestalt-like perceptual experience in which emotions are perceived and then felt. In his 2006 Sweet Anticipation, Music and the Psychology of Expectation, David Huron introduces us to the notion of musical frisson, the cognitive, psychophysiological thrills, chills, or shivers that one perceives while listening to a particularly expressive musical passage. Huron's description of music-induced frisson stems largely from the work of John Sloboda, whose 1991 study at Kiel University attributes the phenomenon to two primary conditions. One, passages that contain some violation of expectation, such as an unexpected harmonic shift or modulation, and two, abrupt changes in dynamic level. These two conditions lie within both the syntactical-statistical and biological-environmental domains of my Venn diagram. Syntactical, because of the shifts in what Meyer would consider a primary musical parameter, harmony, and statistical, because of the change in a secondary musical parameter, dynamics. And because both of these conditions play with our sense of expectation and our fight or flight response, we can consider these biological or environmental as well. Despite the importance and validity of Sloboda's hypothesis, The opening four measures of Debussy's cello sonata, L-135, presents a problem for my frisson-like response to this passage. Here, our expectations for any sudden harmonic and or dynamic shifts are simply not fulfilled. A simple harmonic analysis shows that there are no unexpected harmonic shifts, unless, of course, we account for the minor dominant chord in measure 2 or the major subdominant chord in measure 4. But such modal harmonization is common in Debussy's music and does not necessarily take us by surprise. Furthermore, there are no abrupt changes in dynamic level. The music remains at a constant forte throughout the passage. Let's take a listen. Then to make of this passage, and the many others like it, which lack the structural features outlined by Huron and Sloboda, yet still contain the potential for strong frisson-like responses. In this presentation, I argue that in order to understand the rich emotional potential of this passage, we must go beyond mere surface-level interactions and their biological ramifications, and instead account for its emergent expressive meaning. In this way, what I hope to account for are the deeper psychological associations that often accompany music's emotions. In order to elucidate these meanings and their expressive interactions, I will provide a semiotic reading of the first four measures of Debussy's cello sonata. The methodology for my analysis is based on Kofi Ogawa's extroversive-introversive semiotic paradigm, which he proposes in his 1991 text, Playing with Signs. This is a twofold approach, containing two distinct analytical processes, extroversive and introversive semiosis. Ogawa borrows these terms from the linguist Roman Jakobson, who describes extroversive semiosis as, quote, the referential link to the exterior world, end quote. More simply put, what Ogawa is concerned with here is the domain of topic theory, where he refers to topics as referential signs for their ability to refer to or point towards that which is extra musical, which often carries a host of expressive associations with it. Ogawa describes his second analytical process, introversive semiosis, as, quote, the reference of each sonic element to the other elements to come, end quote. This second class of signs, which Ogawa calls pure signs, provide clues to musical organization through conventional use, and not necessarily through referential or extra-musical means. Here, we are concerned with syntactical, specifically harmonic, relationships. To illustrate some of these relationships, Ogawa borrows a Schenker-inspired analytical technique from Ratner called two-voice contrapuntal frameworks. These show voice leading at a more local level, as opposed to Schenker's more global approach. I adopt this system as well, which I will show a bit later on. What is most important, however, is the integration or intersection of these two semiotic systems. Ogawa claims that holding these two systems as two distinct entities and not considering the integration between the extroversive and the introversive, or the outer versus the inner, or the expressionist versus the structuralist, would be artificial and, quote, ultimately false, end quote. Ogawa's solution to this matter resides somewhere in the middle, between the extroversive and the introversive, what he calls regions of play. And it is here where this model reaps its richest rewards. Ogawa tells us that, quote, structure shades into topic, topic into structure, and this is music, end quote. In the following analysis of Debussy's cello sonata, I will demonstrate how semiotic systems like Ogawa's extroversive-introversive model not only contribute to understandings of how meanings become emergent from a piece of music, but also how they lead towards more complex and nuanced understandings of frisson-like responses. I'll begin by examining the topical content in the opening bars of Debussy's sonata as part of an extroversive semiosis. The opening triplet figure, shown in measure 1 and then repeated in measure 3, sets the music into motion. Forward motion specifically, with a sense of vigor and tenacity, similar to that of French élan. In French, élan describes an object or subject that embodies an exuberance, vigor, vitality, and lively spirit. It is with these rhetorical associations in mind that I read this gesture as a variation of the coup d'archet topic. Originally discussed in 18th and 19th century treatises as a general term for bow stroke, the coup d'archet is typically associated with loud introductory tutti passages, often played in unison. Proverbial examples of this topic are found in Mozart's Jupiter Symphony, K551, and Prague Symphony, K504. Both of these excerpts, in addition to Debussy's, make use of the coup d'archet's characteristic quick triplet pattern. You will have noticed, however, that Debussy's rendition utilizes a double neighbor note figure that rotates around the tonic pitch as opposed to Mozart's more typical stepwise ascent. It is for this reason that I suspect that Debussy was drawing not on 18th century classical models, such as Mozart, but rather a Spanish-Arab tradition of ornamentation. Nonetheless, the effect is the same, an extroverted display of passion, tenacity, and elan. The gesture that resides between the two coup d'archet topics is anything but an extroverted display of confidence and passion. In fact, it is quite the opposite. I have labeled this melodic descent, starting at the F4 that begins halfway through measure 1 to the B-flat 3 halfway through measure 2, as the sensibility and finsamkeit topic. The punctuated psi motive in measure 2, involving the melancholic 5th and lowered 6th scale degrees, confirms the topic's identity. According to Matthew Heed, some of the key terms for conceptualizing the sensibility topic are, quote, consciousness, subjectivity, and reflexivity, end quote. To summarize, Debussy has presented us with a very expressive topical drama by combining two rhetorically opposed topics. The elan and passion of the opening coup d'archet is quickly negated by the melancholic turn toward the sensibility topic, only to be reversed once more by the excitement of the coup d'archet. It is this progression of topics, however, that combine or synthesize into a higher level trope where both meaning and emotion emerge from their unique combination. I'll now turn my attention toward the other half of Ogawu's semiotic model, introversive semiosis. Here, as I mentioned before, Ogawu is concerned with harmonic syntax and voice leading, as opposed to topical content and the rhetorical associations, as we just saw. And, as I also previously mentioned, Ogawu draws on Ratner's two-voice contrapuntal framework to illustrate some of these local voice-leading processes. The last system of this excerpt shows my two-voice contrapuntal framework for these opening bars. The first thing to take note of here is the piano's static and immovable upper tessitura, specifically the stacked thirds, A4 and F4, in measures 1 through 3. These two covering notes constrain or contain the melodic line to the inner voice of the piano, and thus hinder its ability to truly flourish or expand to any large intervallic range. It is not until the second half of measure 3, where B-flats become B-naturals, that the melodic line is actually able to break through this upper register. Furthermore, the contrary motion between the outer voices serves to open up the musical space, which then allows for the cello to blossom out of the texture in measure 4. Also, chant-like open fifths in the left hand of measures 1 through 3 further reinforces this notion of stasis by providing a harmonic weight to the texture. The two-voice contrapuntal framework, shown on the bottom system of my diagram, shows that the opening phrase favors the 5th scale degree, A. After the line reaches the 4th scale degree at the minor dominant 7th chord in measure 2, it then resolves to scale degree 3, F sharp in the inner voice. Thus, scale degree 4 is thwarted, and so the line must initiate itself once more. The arrow connecting A3 to A4 demonstrates that this is done by a reaching over of the melodic line. This justifies the opening phrase's 2 plus 2 phrase construction and the this time successful repeat of the coup d'archet. The final and most important step of Ogawu's model is to consider how the two domains of semiotic analysis that I have covered in this presentation, the extroversive and the introversive, interact, shade, or play with one another. What we find from their interaction are two sets of oppositions. The first opposition is a topical one, which I have shown as part of an extroversive semiosis. Here, the elan and passion associated with the opening coup d'archet is negated by the subjective inward turn of the sensibility topic. Whereas the second attempt at the coup d'archet was successful due to Debussy's strategic use of voice leading. Thus, these two rhetorically opposed topics create an expressive topical drama. The second opposition occurs at a more abstract level between topical and harmonic activity. The melodic line that yearns to flourish and move forward is suppressed by the blocking effect of the stacked thirds, while the chant-like open fifths in the lower register adds to this notion by providing a harmonic weight to the texture. These harmonic characteristics combine and weigh heavily against the melody. Ultimately, expressive meaning in these opening bars hinges on both the confrontation and dependency between these two sets of oppositions, and it is precisely where they interact and merge into a synthetic gestalt that we perceive them as a complex whole, where expressive meaning and its correlating emotions become emergent. Now, with these new perspectives in mind, let's listen to this excerpt once more. In conclusion, what I've attempted to show is that frisson-like responses to music ultimately warrant explanations that go well beyond the music's surface. Of course, we cannot and should not ignore the syntactical and statistical ramifications that Huron and Sloboda so aptly describe in their description of musical frisson. But to reduce the complexity of musical emotions to a series of structural parameters is to miss a crucial component of understanding music's emotions. Therefore, as I have argued in this presentation, one way that we can account for some of these complexities is to include the implications of expressive meaning. And just as Agawu tells us that the extroversive and introversive shade into one another to create music, so do the multiple systems of understanding music's emotions. Thank you.